that which you love. So that for me is the first step of the ladder. If you understand how incredible, how beautiful, how wonderful and how amazing bees are, you're more likely to want to go away and do something with the information that I give you afterwards. So I'm going to start by telling you what is not a bee. And I have no idea whether you're going to be able to see the photographs I've brought. I don't know whether the light's going to be okay, so I'll just try this. Can you see that? So this is not a bee. This is a fly pretending to be a bee. It's called Mullerian mimicry, and it protects the fly from predators because it looks as if it's a bee and predators think bees are going to sting. So that is not a bee, and it's just worthwhile knowing this, because when you start, I hope after today, next time you sort of see anything fuzzy flying around, you might want to sit down and have a look and try and work out what it is. So I'm going to show you how you can tell what is not a bee. And the first thing to notice is this is also not a bee. It has huge fly eyes. So bees have kind of friendly, kind-looking oval eyes on the side of their heads. Flies have big, big fly eyes that kind of join together in the middle. And that's one way that you can think, if something is fuzzy and furry and it's flying by you, if it's got big eyes like that, it's a fly. The other thing that may be less easy to see is two tiny little stumpy antennae. Flies have tiny little antennae. Bees have big, you've seen, when you see the cartoon bees, they always have these great big antennae. So that's another way. That's even with the tiniest bees in the UK, you can still see, if you look closely, that they have antennae. Another thing is that this has got a very thick set waist. It's really solid, it's a fly, whereas bees have waspish waists. Their waists are sort of tight, a little bit like wasps. So those three things, plus there are some other physiological things, like bees have two sets of wings, white flies have one, but you won't really notice that. But that's basically how you can tell the difference between a fly and a bee. But it's important to say at this stage that the flies are also important. You know, bees are not the planet's only pollinators. We have on planet Earth some 200,000 species of pollinating animal. And between them, they are responsible for pollinating about 352,000 species of plant, flowering plant. So that's what's going on, you know, in a great big global scale. And then if you bring it back down to bees, there are 20,000 species of bee on the planet. And then further down to the UK, in the UK we have 267 species of bee. One of them is a honeybee. There's one honeybee. There are about 25 different species of bumblebee, and the rest are solitary bees. And people, that there are people who have never heard, I don't know if any of you have heard of solitary bees, or would recognise a solitary bee, I was going to say, if it bit you but they don't bite you, but if you saw one. So between them, these bees are incredibly, incredibly important. You've probably read, because there's so many statistics in the media now, you've probably read that they are responsible between them for pollinating around about a third of all of the food on our plates. And again, it's important to know that that is not just fruit and vegetables and edible flowers. This also includes, for those of you who eat meat, the meat on your plates is usually fed on plants like clover and alfalfa, which are pollinated exclusively by bees. So if you were to wake up and, if we were to have a world without bees, your diet would be seriously restricted. You'd have bread and you'd have porridge, and there wouldn't be much more than that. Very, very little variety. But as regards bee decline, one of the issues I have with bee decline is that at the moment, most of us are seeing it in a very human-centric way. And we're worried about it for ourselves. We're worried about it because of the human food chain. You know, the bees are referred to all too often as pollinating, they're pollinator services. And I think to call a bee, to give another living creature the name service, you know, they provide pollinating service. And I mean, when did a bee ever send you an invoice? They do not charge for their time. They are so incredible. They do so much work. And it's not just the human food chain that we should be concerned about. It's also, when I come back to them being keystone species, they are also incredibly important when it comes to pollinating all of the flowering plants. So about 80% of all the flowering plants are pollinated by bees, and these are the plants that, you know, without the plant being pollinated, the seeds won't set, the seed-eating birds will die out. There's already bee decline, it's already impacting on small farmland birds and amphibians and reptiles. You know, this, as I said at the beginning, is not just about bees. So I want to just very, very quickly, I have to fly through so much of this. I mean, I could talk to you for a whole day just about bumblebees, which clearly I'm not able to do today, but I just want to touch on pollination and show you a couple of different ways that bees pollinate plants. I don't even know if you'd have noticed. I don't know how many of you have ever taken time to sit in your gardens and watch the bees. And I think if people took more time to sit and just be, an awful lot of our problems would disappear. So this is a bee, and she's crawling into a bindweed. These are everywhere at the moment, and they are fantastic for bees. The sort of plant that people think of as weeds and rip up whenever they can and take out. And I've got a friend who is a plant shaman, and what she does with plants like bindweed that are fantastic for bees, but that gardeners think of as invasive, if she communicates with them, she'll go up into her garden and she'll sit with the bindweed or whatever, and she'll gently ask it to maybe stay where it is and not invade her garden. And it's the sort of thing I know that, you know, you might not want to do with a lot of people watching you, but it works. It's worked for her, and her bindweed has not encroached on the rest of her garden. She hasn't had to pluck it out. She's told it that if it does invade, she will have to take it out. And it stayed very, very nicely exactly where it was in the back of the garden. So what this bee's doing is, you can see she's going for the nectaries. The nectaries are one of the rewards. Bees are going either for nectar or pollen. Nectar gives them the energy to fly. Nectar is like, it's the carbohydrate. It's like our rice and potatoes and pasta, the sugars. And the pollen is the protein. The pollen builds the larva that she will be taking this back to the nest or back to the colony, depending on what sort of bee she is. And while she's doing that, she will pollinate the plant. So you can see here that the pollen on the stamen here, it's white pollen, it's going to brush on her back. If she were a tiny bee, a minuscule bee, she wouldn't pollinate this plant while she was collecting nectar from it. So different plants get pollinated by different sized bee. You need to be a pretty big bee to actually pollinate this plant. Then you've got, so the size of the bee is relevant, but also the length of the tongue. And bees have tongues that vary from about 5 millimetres to 15 millimetres in length. And to put it in perspective, honeybees' tongues are 6.3 millimetres long. So a honeybee is a short-tongued bee. A honeybee would not be able to pollinate something like sage, which has got a really deep corolla. This takes a bee with a long tongue. And I don't know if you can actually see the tongue on this, but this bee... this is a bumblebee, and it's called the garden bumblebee, Bombus hortorum. And she has the longest tongue. Her tongue is so long that she doesn't bother winding it up between flowers. So if you see a very typical bumblebee-looking bee flying around your broad beans or your beans or your sage, and she has a long tongue and it's hanging out, it will probably be this bee. So the way she pollinates is she will perch on the ledge of the flower, which is perfectly designed for this purpose, and she will reach into the flower, and her tongue will go all the way down to the bottom to access the nectar. So that's how she collects her nectar, and then the plant will be pollinated while she's doing that. Other bees with shorter tongues might bypass this, and what they will do is they'll do something that it's called robbing or larceny. It's actually a crime, and well, you would think so given the name larceny. And what another bee will do is they'll come and drill a hole through the bottom here and go straight for the nectaries, access the nectar, and completely bypass the act of pollination. So that's something that farmers don't like. They don't like the bees going and doing that. There's another way that bees pollinate, and this is... so honeybees are fantastic in large numbers for large crops, but they are not the world's most important pollinators. There's been an awful lot of research recently that has proved this. You know, they are important, but it's the wild bees that do the lion's share of the pollinating. And especially with the honeybee population crashing at the moment, you know, whilst we're looking for ways to solve that and to find out, well, I'll come to what's causing that later, we need our wild bees more than ever before. And in areas where they have been outcompeted in the States by you know, honeybees that have been farmed, like a monoculture, like battery chickens of the insect world, that the wild bees have disappeared. And now we've reached the stage where the honeybees are disappearing. There are no indigenous wild bees in some areas to take on the role of pollinating. So this is really important that we are aware of this. And this is a tomato plant. Tomato plants don't give up their pollen easily. That's tight shut. And very few bees have found a way around this, but bumblebees know exactly what to do in this situation, as do some solitary bees. And what they do is the bumblebee will fly along and she will grasp onto the flower here, and she does this amazing thing where she disconnects her wings from inside her thorax and she starts to vibrate the flight muscles. So the flight muscles are vibrating, but the wings are not. And the whole plant vibrates like a tuning fork. And she's vibrating it between 250 and 400 hertz. And suddenly, the plant opens and smacks out its pollen onto the bee that's underneath. And that's how we get cross-pollination and therefore cross-fertilization with tomatoes. And it's so important, you know. Tomatoes can self-pollinate. There are lots of plants that can self-pollinate, but this is not the same. This is like us interbreeding. This we need diversity, genetic diversity. It's crucial that we have genetic diversity so that we will have healthy tomatoes. And again, strawberries, you know, we can pollinate the strawberries. Strawberries are self-pollinating, but if you don't have a bee, if you don't have open pollination, natural pollination going on, you get a distorted dwarf a strawberry that really is not even fit to eat. So that's something that's terribly important that the bumblebees do. Now the downside to this for the bumblebees is what we humans see. We see an opportunity there. And so now bumblebees are farmed. And bumblebees are farmed in mostly in Eastern Europe. And they're basically, they are kept inside. They are fed on diets of often pollen substitute, sometimes it's real pollen, but often it's a pollen substitute, and on high fructose corn syrup instead of nectar, which is invariably genetically modified. And they are given carbon dioxide to make them overwinter at the time that is suitable for us rather than them, so that they can be shipped in boxes to the United States and the UK to pollinate our tomato houses and our great big polytunnels. I'm talking monocultures here. I'm not talking allotments and sort of small growers. And so they're bought in. So the way they have been bred is not good. They're bought into the UK. They're stationed in their little boxes along the greenhouses. And they do their job very, very well. And then they are drowned or frozen because they cannot be sent back and they are not allowed to escape, or they're supposed not to escape, because they are not the same strain. This is usually Bombus terrestris, the buff-tailed bumblebee. But it's a Turkish strain. So it's a Turkish strain of bee bred in Eastern Europe and brought over here and used to pollinate our tomatoes, frozen or drowned. And then there's an extra sting in the tail, a twist in this tail, because of course some of them escape. And they're escaping and they're diseased, these bees. You know, a bee that has been brought up like that, like a human, if we were just fed one food all of our lives and kept in the dark, we would not have strong immune systems. We would be prone to all sorts of diseases. And there are lots of diseases that these bees carry, the bumblebees, but there's one in particular called Crithidia bombi. And what it does is it impairs the bee's natural ability to tell whether there is still nectar in a plant, because usually bees leave smelly footprints on plants after they've landed, so the next bee comes along and knows, a bee's just been here, and incredibly, with their minute sort of pinhead-sized brains, they have a knowing that this plant will only produce nectar again in another 2 minutes or 6 hours, so they bypass it. But a bee that has Crithidia bombi doesn't have that ability, so it'll visit lots and lots of flowers with no nectar, until it runs out of energy, because the energy from the nectar is its fuel, and it will starve to death, it'll die. So that's just one little thing, that's one consequence of what we're doing, you know, because we are taking these creatures and using them to our own ends to get more tomatoes throughout the year when we really don't need them. So I'm going to move on from that, leave that one behind. I want to talk to you a bit about how the bees, I've shown different flowers, I mean that was a nutshell of how different bees will access different flowers, but they collect their pollen in different ways. And you're probably well aware of what a honeybee looks like when she is carrying pollen. And honeybees and bumblebees both carry their pollen in the same way. So both of these bees are social bees. By social, I mean that they live in communities, in colonies. And honeybees are kind of like the most, the way they have developed their social interaction is second to none in the insect world. And then you go to the other end of the scale and you've got the solitary bees that just basically do everything on their own and don't interact or communicate. So the definition of a social bee is a bee that will communicate and cooperate. And this happens obviously in honeybee colonies, and then it also happens in bumblebee colonies. So but in a honeybee colony you might have 50,000-60,000 bees. You've got one queen bee who does not wear a crown. She serves the colony. In the honeybee colony, every single thing that every bee does, they do for the greater good of the whole. They're almost all females. All the workers in the world of bees are female. The males in the world of bees do no work. They breed. They are there to help, provide future generations. But so you've got 50,000-60,000 honeybees in a hive or a colony, it could be in a hollow in a tree. And then you've got in a bumblebee colony, depending on the species. So the big bumblebees that live deep beneath the ground in old rodents, abandoned rodents' nests, they might have up to 300 or 400 bumblebees, at the height of the season if it's a really strong colony. Whereas the ones that nest just underneath leaves on the ground, so that'd be the tiniest bumblebee called the early nesting bumblebee, or the one that I just showed you with the long tongue, she nests underneath sort of leaves in the surface, and they might only have 50 bees. But what they're doing is they're all aiming to bring pollen back to the nest to feed the larva, as are the solitary bees, which I'll talk to you a little bit more in a minute. But I just wanted to show you, this is what you would think of. This is a photograph. This is bumblebee, is carrying pollen. She can carry up to 90% of her body weight in pollen, which, considering that bumblebees are not supposed to be able to fly, is a pretty amazing thing. She would also, but not as well as pollen, but she might be carrying nectar. She could carry up to 90% of her body weight in nectar in her honey crop. So if you see a bee with large, tidy balls of pollen on her hind legs, it's called the corbicula, you know it's either a bumblebee or a honeybee. Okay? Now, solitary bees carry their pollen in an entirely different way. And I just want to show you as well, in case you think pollen is just orange or yellow or red, and you probably can't see this, but this bee is on Phacelia, and she's carrying fluorescent purple pollen. So the pollen comes in so many different colours. And if you're really into pollen colours, like me, you can get an ID chart. And you can get a little bit like a paint chart that shows you all the different shades of pollen and tells you what plant they're likely to come from. So, when you get into bees, you can go off in so many different directions. It takes you into so many different worlds, the worlds of plants, the world of pollination, the world of food, pollination ecology, which I'm only just starting to get my head around. So pollination is fascinating. So the solitary bees, this is a tip for how you can tell, A, whether it is a solitary bee, and B, whether it lives in a hole in the ground or a hole in a cavity. So if it is a bee that's nesting in a wall or in a bamboo tube or in a raspberry cane or in a teapot spout or your wind chimes or underneath your plant pot, she will carry her pollen underneath her abdomen. So she doesn't have pollen baskets. She has these really stiff branched hairs, forked hairs, called scopa, and they look like this. So I've brought this photograph along because this is a leaf cutter bee, and there are leaf cutters all over the place at the moment. I've never seen a year with so many leaf cutter bees. And if in your garden you have got something like rose leaves or evening primrose or just basically thinnish leaves, rose bay leaves. Leaves are a little bit smooth on top and a little bit unsmooth underneath. And they have got tiny, semicircular little nibbles out of them. So very, very precise. Then you will have leaf cutters nesting in your garden. And they are amazing pollinators. So if you think the honeybee and the bumblebee carries these big, neat balls of pollen on her legs, she's not going to drop much of that between plants. So she's going to get a bit of pollen on her head or on her body as she travels between plants. But the pollen she's actually collecting is not going to pollinate the next plant she goes to. These bees are seriously messy bees. They're incredibly messy. They roll around and have baths in whatever plant they're pollinating. And they are taking a load of pollen with them onto the next plant. So for this reason, all of the bees, see that, yeah? All of the bees that collect pollen like this are amazing pollinators. And there's a bee similar to this called the red mason, Osmia rufa. It's a bee that is possibly the most important bee for our apple orchards. And one single female solitary red mason bee can do the same amount of work as 120 honeybees. So that's really, really amazing pollinator. Now, just before I go on to the other way that solitary bees collect their pollen, I must say that I don't want in any way for you to think that I am negating the importance of the honeybee. The honeybee is equally important. All of these bees are important. And something I've come across a lot in the bee world is you get all these people who, you know, they all have their favourite bees. And you get honeybee people who kind of ignore and block out the wild bees. And you get wild bee people who ignore and block out honeybees. But they're all important. And the thing we should be learning from honeybees and bumblebees is to cooperate and communicate and work together and not, you know, to have no ego sort of covering everything that we do. So, the other type of solitary bee, so you've got the cavity nesting bees carrying the pollen underneath, then you've got a ground nesting bee. If you see something, it could be as small as a grain of rice. Our smallest bee in the UK is no bigger than a grain of rice, and it's black, and it pollinates the harebells. And you would just think it's a mosquito or a gnat or something like that. But I've already explained, it will have antennae if it's a bee, and it'll have a little waspish waist, and it'll have nice friendly eyes instead of big fly eyes. And if it also has, and this is a blown up photograph, so you wouldn't see this with the naked eye so easily, if its legs are covered in hairs, stiff hairs, from kind of the bottom of the leg all the way up to the top, all the way up to the waist, then you are looking at a ground nesting solitary bee. You're looking at a bee that nests beneath the ground. By solitary, I mean she has one hole, one nest, one female, no worker caste, no communication, no cooperation. You might see an area the size of this brown carpet covered in tiny little holes, you know, smaller than the size of a pencil, and you might see thousands of bees. And if this is the type of ground that these bees prefer, is they like compacted, sandy soil in a south-facing position that needs to be well drained. That's the most perfect land for a solitary bee, a ground-nesting solitary bee. And that's what she looks like before she's collected her pollen. And this is the same bee who's collected her pollen. So you've got, can you see? It's all the way from her, like her knee joint, all the way up to her body. Just loads and loads and loads of pollen. It's difficult sometimes to see the solitary bees, even more so than the others, because they are so busy. You know, they're sort of whizzing around from place to place, and it's very, very difficult to be able to stop and look at them with a magnifying glass. If you do, I don't know if there's anyone here who's scared of bees, but there's this whole myth about bees being dangerous and wanting to sting you. Bees have better things to do than sting human beings. They're on a mission. They're out there working. They will only sting you if you are digging up their nest, sort of going and crashing into a hive or a colony, sitting on them, standing on them, squashing them. Bees are not naturally aggressive, and especially not the bumblebees and the solitary bees. there are only one or two solitary bees that can actually pierce the human skin with a sting if you squash them and if they try to sting you. So all of the solitary bees, you know, like the 250 odd species of solitary bee, are so safe, really, really good for children. So you've got, I just want to, having got that sting thing out of the way, I want to tell you also that male bees do not sting at all. So a male bee does not have a sting. Just as another little tip, because it's nice, I would hope that you go away from today looking at bees twice and a little bit more closely. And I'm going to tell you now how you can tell the difference between a male bumblebee and a female bumblebee. So if it's got pollen on its legs, it's clearly a female bumblebee because they do all the work. If it has no pollen, it could still be a female bumblebee out foraging for nectar, or it couldn't be a male bumblebee. If it's asleep inside a flower, it is a male bumblebee. gets a lot better. So, shall I tell you why? The reason that if you see a little bee asleep inside of a flower, it's because when they leave the nest, the male bumblebees, they're not allowed back in. They don't do the washing up. So this is a little male bumblebee asleep very early in the morning inside a strawberry flower. I think not. So that is a clue. Okay, this is a clue. This is probably a male bumblebee. I've also mentioned that the female bumblebees, they carry the pollen on the back of their legs, so they have big, widened, smooth, the top of their legs, they're widened and smooth. Male bumblebees have sort of long, thin, hairy legs. So that's another way you can tell the difference between a female. This is a male. This is actually something called a cuckoo bumblebee as well, just complicated. But it's sleeping inside a flower. It's got skinny, hairy legs. You're getting, I'm thinking this is a male bumblebee, not in a hurry to go anywhere or do anything. And then there's one last clue, and this doesn't apply to all of our species, but for most of the UK species, the males have facial hair. They have yellow moustaches.
Speak English and Welsh.
Completely. So that is, this is a male, it's Bombus leucorum. It's a, can you see it at the back? It's a white-tailed bumblebee, complete with his very, very beautiful yellow moustache. So that's how you should be able to go away today. And if you see a bee that's doing all of that, you could hazard a pretty good guess that it's a male bumblebee. Also, the stinging thing, just to come back to the stinging thing for a moment. If a bumblebee is not happy with your presence, she will tell you, or he will tell you, because the males also do this. And they do this, they posture. So I'm often sort of right up close with a camera or with a magnifying glass looking at the bees just anywhere and everywhere. And if they are low on energy, they can't fly off. You know, if they don't like you being there, they usually fly off. If they don't fly off, it's because they're low on energy. And they will tell you that they're not happy with you being in their space by lifting one of their middle legs in the air. So they'll lift the middle leg and you will politely back off, and she will politely put her middle leg down. If you don't back off, she'll lift two of her middle legs in the air, which is fine because she's got six legs. And then if she's really, really unhappy with you, she'll actually put her legs right up in the air like that, and then she'll turn on her back and show you her sting, because she has got a sting. She still won't use it. Seriously, the chances of you being stung by a bumblebee are so remote, unless you are an aggressor. This bumblebee is not going to want to sting you. So this is a photograph of a bee posturing. So this is a bee I rescued from the road. You often see bees on pavements and roads, tarmacs and things like that. And the kindest thing to do is to, don't be frightened of them, put your hand down, put your finger down and let her crawl onto your hand. And it's the most amazing bonding experience. You know, whatever you think of bees, when you then carry her to the side of the road and she crawls along your finger. And I've never known anybody to be stung when doing this, ever, ever, ever. And then gently put her, if you can, on a flowering plant, preferably a blue one. So that's so much more I could tell you about bumblebees, but I just want to tell you a little bit about the ground nesting solitary bees that I mentioned earlier. Really just to show you some photographs of one of the most easy to recognise, so that if you see it next year, you've missed it this year, but if you see it next year, you'll recognise it. And this is a bee called the ashy mining bee. Her sort of posh name is Andrina cineraria. And this is her. You remember I said that you might see lots of holes in the ground. This is a little solitary bee. This is the ashy mining bee just poking her head up out of the hole in the ground. And she's a little bit like the snow leopard of the insect world. She's just this beautiful black and silvery grey colour. That's the male of the species. And the male, all of the male solitary bees are a little bit slimmer and a little bit smaller than the females. So that there's a male ashy mining bee. This is the female. So she really is very, very stunning. She's a tiny little bee, but she's unmistakable. So if you see a bee like this, you know you are, that there is no other bee that looks quite like this. And she will be flying around. There'll be lots of them. They're not living in a colony. They're living separate lives in little holes beneath the ground. And what she does, I'm just going to quickly tell you what she does because it's fascinating, is she will find a piece of ground and she will burrow into it with her mouth parts. And then once she's got a hold, she starts digging with her front, I was going to call them paws, but with her front legs. And she'll go deeper and deeper and she will wedge her back elbows into the hole and start digging a little bit like a terrier. So you kind of get this miniature little molehill on the ground. And then she goes down, 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 and she branches off into a tunnel, makes a little miniature egg-shaped cavity at the end, and then she lines that with tiny bits of mud. And then she does something even more clever. She secretes from underneath her abdomen a kind of a substance that's waterproof. And it's antiviral, antibacterial, antifungal. And she has underneath her bottom a plasterer's trowel. And she smears this substance all the way over the inside of this little cell to make it waterproof. Fills it with pollen and nectar. Lays an egg. Backfills the tunnel. And then she'll do that maybe half a dozen more times in this beneath the ground. She might have 30 or 40 eggs. And then she's spent. She's done. She's finished with them. She will die. And underneath the ground, the eggs will hatch. They'll go through the larval stage, the pupal stage, and then they will be full adult bees within about 5 or 6 weeks. And then they stay there hibernating beneath the ground until next year. And they come out, solitary bees come out when the flower that they pollinate blooms, which is amazing. And even with a late spring like this, you think, gosh, it's really, really worrying because the flowers are coming out. And with some species of bee, you know, the poor old bumblebee will just come out and then if we have a bad winter like we did, you know, they'll just be battered by the snow and the rain and so on. But the solitary bees somehow have this innate knowledge of knowing that when things are late or early, they kind of respond to that, which is quite incredible. Really good backup bees for pollinating, you know, the food and the flowers on the planet. I'm just going to show you some photographs of some other solitary bees before I talk about the reasons for bee decline. So I mentioned red mason bees. Red mason bees are great fruit pollinators. This is a pair of red mason bees that I sat on by mistake last year on my patio, but they were fine. So you can see that the male's a lot smaller than the female. This is a female red mason bee with really powerful jaw parts because she blocks up all of the cells where she lays her eggs with bits of mud. So she gets balls of mud, blocks them up. If you've heard of bee hotels, it's the red mason bee that is the most likely bee to come to your bee hotel, and that is a bee hotel. It's just a load of bamboo, you know, you can drill holes or whatever. They do prefer, bizarrely, instead of, you know, you can give them a choice of all the wonderful natural bamboos and old plant stems, and then you stick a couple of man-made cardboard tubes, and they go for the man-made cardboard tubes every time, because they don't have to do any work with them whatsoever. So that's a word of advice. If you are thinking of being all sort of perfect and natural and rustic, you may be not providing the best nest sites. Maybe best to go online and buy some sort of cardboard tubes. This is the following year. I haven't got time to go through the life cycle, but this is the first bee chomping his way out of the mud. Can you tell? You can see his eyes and his jaws. So this is, the males are always laid at the front, so he's chomping his way out here. This is him taking his first steps. So he's coming out. And again, he has a moustache too. So more creamy than yellow, but still very moustachey. This is another, it's called an osmia species, and I found this in my garden up in Malvern last year. She makes her nest in abandoned snail shells. So that's how she makes her nest. Okay, this one's not English, but it's I just brought this along because it's so beautiful. There's a Turkish solitary bee called Osmia abosetta or something like that, and she makes her nest, she lines it with flower petals. So this is minuscule. This is way smaller than the top segment of my little finger. Thinner than a biro. So this is what these bees are amazing. The lives of bees are just incredible, and we know so little about them. I mean, I've been doing very little else the last 3 or 4 years, and I just touched on the tip of the iceberg. And every day I learn something new that's just mind blowing. This is a very territorial solitary bee. It's called the wool carding bee, and this is a male. He has 3 spikes. It's a bit like a gladiator. He's got these spikes on his tail, and he uses them to defend the lamb's ear from all other bees. And he does it really, really well. So he protects it for the females who use the lamb's ear to card the wool to fill their nests up with. He basically will chase anything off. He'll chase a large bumblebee. And there is one other bee that's also territorial called the hairy-footed flower bee. The female is black. If you have tiny black bees in your garden, on your lungwort or your comfrey or your wallflowers, and they've got really long proboscis and they're darting around like this, then you have got hairy-footed flower bees in your garden. If you have those plants, you will attract hairy-footed flower bees. But the male is similar to the wool carding bee. He protects the patch of flowers from all other bees. And I've read a report by a scientist who's been studying these bees and observing them, where she has seen one of... This is the male hairy-footed flower bee with very, very beautiful hairy feet. This bee has been seen chasing a robin off his patch. So this is a seriously territorial bee. So that's all the photographs. I'm going to talk now about bee decline because it's important. Bee decline is complex, incredibly complex. There is no one reason for bee decline, and so many people are trying to blame different things. But there are myriad reasons for bee decline, and a couple of them I'm not going to mention but not go into. So climate change is a problem. It's tangible. We have seen this year the devastating effects it's had on bees and butterflies and all other insects. Whether it's the winter or the summer, it doesn't matter. It's causing huge, huge problems. Electronic pollution, mobile phones, Wi-Fi. As far as I'm concerned, that's a problem, but I'm not going to focus on that because there is not sufficient peer-reviewed evidence to back it up, which means it's something that is... I need to do more research myself to be able to talk on this, and it detracts from the big ones. So disease is another one. Disease, all sorts of fungal diseases and bacterial diseases and viruses that all the different species of bees are going down with. But then the two big ones are habitat loss and pesticides. So habitat loss, I kind of see a little bit like the war. It's big and it's ongoing. It's been ongoing for some time. And it's been picking up and picking up for many, many decades. But if we go back to the end of the Second World War, that's probably when things really started to change, with the introduction, the mechanization of agriculture and the industrialization of agriculture. The crop rotation stopped. The way that the farmers used to farm and had farms since medieval times was suitable for bees and pollinators and wildlife. It went hand in hand. Farm management was like wildlife management. That all stopped with the mechanization and industrialization of agriculture. Then in the 60s came pesticides. And if any of you have not read Rachel Carson's book, Silent Spring, I would urge you to get a copy, because what Rachel Carson wrote in the 60s is as relevant, if not more relevant and important today, as it was in the 60s. So we started, you know, the landscape starts to change, and then we get to common market grants. And farmers were given grants, 70s and 80s, they were given grants to grub out their hedgerows and fill in their ponds and chop down their small spinneys, and basically to plant wheat or corn to the very, very edges of their land. So we've got people being paid to grow monocrops. Now farmers are being paid subsidies to put in field margins and to put hedgerows back. But it's too late for that land. You know, we now have, if you look at the landscape, you might still have a woodland area. You've got the habitat for the bees to hibernate and to mate. But if you look around it, what used to be wildflower meadows and grasslands, they're gone. We've lost 98% of our wildflower meadows and grasslands since the end of the Second World War. And what we've got now is what looks... I've got a friend who lives in the countryside, and she thinks she's really lucky. She lives in this incredible area, and look at it. It's all so green. But it's a green desert. There's nothing growing there other than food, monocrops for human beings, and there's very little sustained bees out in the countryside. So habitat loss is a giant, giant problem. Pesticides is even bigger than we think it is. And the pesticides, basically, we started back in the 60s with pesticides being used reactively. So reactively means you get an infestation, you treat it with pesticides. Still not good. But at least it's not as it is today. Today, pesticides are used prophylactically. So they are dosed, you know, the crops are treated before the pest. Or, you know, sometimes there isn't even a pest for that crop. It's just that farmers, there's this fear-mongering that has been put out there by the pesticides company and by the NFU as well, who do not support small farmers. The NFU, the National Farmers Union, really more about big sort of billionaire farmers and landowners. So we've got, our land is just being saturated with fungicides, herbicides, insecticides. You know, they all come under the umbrella term pesticides. There's a cocktail out there now. And when bees are dying in their billions, they're not just numbers but species. We're losing species and we're losing numbers. And when you examine the dead body of a bee, you know, there could be 20 plus different pesticides in the body of that bee. So it's no wonder it succumbs. You know, at the very least, its immune system is going to be zapped. The pesticides that have been in the news recently, and it's a group of pesticides I've been campaigning really hard to raise awareness of for quite some years now, are neonicotinoids, or some people pronounce them neonicotinoids. Or you can, if you can't do either of that, just call them neonics. Neonicotinoids have been around since the mid-80s, and they are a particularly nasty group of pesticides. So firstly, they are systemic. So they're not sprayed, or some of them are sprayed. So this is not a pesticide that's sprayed. The seed is coated. So the entire crop of corn or rapeseed, oilseed rape, or flax or sunflower or potatoes, it really doesn't matter. The entire crop is coated, every single seed, or the ground is saturated. Now, what happens when this seed goes into the ground is, because it's systemic, it takes the pesticide up, down into its roots, and up into the stem, and into the leaves, into the flowers, into the pollen, and into the nectar, and the entire plant is infused with the neonicotinoid, which is a neurotoxin. So it's a nerve poison, and it's designed to impair the nervous system of its target insects. Its target insects are things like aphids or Colorado potato beetle or the pollen beetle or termites. But bees are insects too. You know, it is impairing the neurological functions of bees and other invertebrates, not just bees and flying insects, but those that live beneath the soil and also our aquatic insects are all being affected by the neonicotinoids. With honeybees, they're not able to find their way back to their colony. So colonies are dying out. You've got this incredibly active, healthy queen and brood, and the workers go out and they just don't return because they've gone to a crop of oilseed rape. And this is basically affecting the bees in something called sublethal doses. So the bee doesn't go to the plant and die outright. It is affected over a period of time it's in sub-lethal doses it's affected. And not only is it affected, but you know, it still might not die, but it can't get back to its nest or its colony, so its brood, the brood dies. So this is one way that these work. They also impair a bee's ability to groom. And with honeybees are so, so clean and tidy and methodical, and everything in a honeybee hive is pristine and mathematical and beautiful and wonderful. And it's not when they have been feeding on these pesticides. So they're not able to get rid, they don't have a chance with mites like varroa. You will have heard, you know, everybody is blaming the varroa mite for bee decline. Not everybody, but it is, it's constantly. And the varroa mite, it's a huge problem for honeybees. But I think it's only really taken a hold because the bees can't fight it off. They're not healthy enough any longer because of the way they've been treated. So they can't fight off something that's giant like the varroa mite. So you've got all of this going on in the hive. In a bumblebee colony, incidentally, you know, whilst the honeybees have this incredible cleanliness, bumblebee colonies are chaotic, beautifully, wonderfully chaotic. And the bumblebees, you know, they look as if they're clean, and they mill around inside the nest or whatever, looking as if they're doing something, but very rarely actually clearing the debris out. And they build all their little pots on top of each other. And when the queen finally produces females and males and stops producing a pheromone, chaos breaks out and anarchy and things. So very, very different. But they are all affected. And there was some research last year that was done by Stirling University on neonicotinoids' effect on bumblebees. So everyone's been researching the honeybee problem. You know, you've got 70 government scientists researching honeybee decline, and half a scientist researching all the other bee decline, you know, a part-time guy. So it's very unbalanced. But there's a guy called Dave Goulson who was at Stirling University until now. He's now at Essex University doing a lot of really good stuff on bees. He was one of the co-founders of the Bumblebee Conservation Trust. And he and a team of scientists in Stirling tested the neonicotinoids in field realistic doses on colonies of bumblebees. And what they did is they took three different groups. So they had a control group, no pesticides, no neonicotinoids. And they had the first group that were given the field realistic doses, and then another group that were given twice the dose of the neonicotinoid. At the end of the season, you know, he didn't know what he was going to find. He was expecting maybe to see smaller size or a little bit of decline in numbers. But what they found was devastating. This control group produced, at the end of the year, on average per colony, 13 new queens. So that's good. 13 new queens. That's a good, healthy colony. The colony that had been given field realistic doses of the insecticide, the neonicotinoid, produced 2 new queens on average. And that had been given double the dose, 1. So that's an 85% decline in requeening, and bumblebees cannot sustain that. You know, they've got enough troubles anyway with the weather and lack of foraging and all the parasites that live beneath the ground that can't wait to sort of dig into hibernating queens. So to have this on top of that is just pushing them to the brink. That's neonicotinoids. There's been a huge focus on neonicotinoids. The government have now agreed to partially and temporarily ban 3 of them. So for 2 years, 3 of them are going to be taken out of commission. It's not going to make a difference. You know, it really isn't. It's almost like a placebo. It's almost to make everybody. And it was fantastic that we achieved that. You know, people who are campaigning with whatever way, the fact that we did achieve that the European Parliament or the EU have called for this ban, but it's nowhere near far enough, and it's not going to solve the problem. And also, whilst the focus has been on the neonicotinoids, there are also the fungicides. And there's brand new research just out in the last couple of weeks that shows that the fungicides are causing desperate problems. And ironically, the honeybees that feed on crops that have been treated with a fungicide are far more likely to fall prey and to be susceptible to fungal diseases like nosema. And then there's also, When beekeepers are treating their honeybees with miticides, and I don't know the names of any of them, they may be getting rid of the varroa, but they are increasing the honeybees' likelihood of falling prey to a fungal disease. So what we've got here is we've got our land is firstly being destroyed in the name of feeding the world, which is another whole issue, and that the wildflowers are all but gone. And these wildflowers are so important for the bees. You know, that they sustain the bees that then are able to pollinate the crops. And then the crops that are there are saturated with fungicides and herbicides and insecticides. So it's really, really is a crazy, ridiculous situation that we find ourselves in. And one of the things that worries me about it is that, you know, the powers that be, and believe me, our government are the worst in Europe. They are the ones that are least wanting to take this on board and deal with the situation. They'll deal with the habitat loss, but not the pesticides issue. And their answer is likely to be, and I can just see them heading there already, that we plant genetically modified crops that don't need pesticides, that don't need herbicides and fungicides and insecticides. So watch out for that, because I think that's where they're going to go next with this. And that, of course, has its own dangers. So what you can do, stop using pesticides of any sort. It's not worth it. It's really not worth it. If there is anyone here who doesn't garden organically and naturally, it only takes 3 years. You know, it's a scary thing for a farmer or a person who needs their crops or loves their roses to put the sprays away and stop buying more. But it only takes 3 years for the balance to come, because nature is balanced. You know, we're not really balanced, but nature, I suppose we are nature arguably, but so we're putting nature out of balance. But nature in your garden is balanced, beautifully balanced, and it will find a level. The beneficial insects will move in, and they will look after the insects that, you know, the aphids that are nibbling your roses or whatever. So if you see a petition, sign it. It may not, the petition itself may not help, but the media interest in the signatures on the petition is getting the word out there, and more people, more and more organisations are now calling for these substances to be banned. And then plant for the world. Just plant. Get out there and go and look and see. Instead of, you know, you can go and you can look at lists on the internet, or you can look and see which plant in your neighbour's garden is covered in bees and ask for a cutting, or for them to save some seeds. If you go to a local garden centre, buy the plants that are covered in bees. As a rule of thumb, plant something blue. Bees don't see in infrared, they see in ultraviolet. So they love the Mediterranean herbs. If you want to plant caviar and champagne for bees, give them viper's bugloss and borage. There's just one website that I always tell everybody about at my talks that you can go to for all of the information about it. It's for pollinating gardening. It's called Foxlees, Foxlees. And I embarrass Mark and say that Mark, who is the creator of the Foxlees website, just happens to be here today. And seriously, please give him a clap, because so much information. So much information on his website, I can't tell you. And unlike lots of the other websites, Mark has done this because he has done this in his garden himself. This is personal knowledge. So if it's on there, it's because he's tried and tested it. And he doesn't just talk about bees. It's the pollinator garden. You know, he's aiming. This is not, I said at the very beginning, I'm talking to you about bees, but this is not just about bees. This is about all life on earth. And that you need to remember that. The other thing that I'm just really going to briefly tell you, because I always forget, is I've got a blog. My blog is bstrawbridge.blog, I think. And I'm also very prolific on Twitter and Facebook as Brigit Strawbridge. And I'm just setting up a project because I do talks. I do talks and workshops, and I write articles. But I want to do something more. So personal circumstances have weirdly and quite frighteningly meant that I have now taken on what was my marital home in Cornwall, because it hasn't sold, along with a monopoly money mortgage. It was either that or, you know, let the bank have it back. And I've decided to turn it, there's 3 acres, it's a farmhouse with 3 acres, and so many different habitats, it's unbelievable. So I'm turning it into, I've renamed it Bumblebee Farm. So you can find me if you look up Bumblebee Farm, to try and cover the mortgage, I've set up a really nice bed and breakfast. It's everything is eco, you know, and organic, and the water for the showers comes from the spring at the bottom of the garden and is pumped up by a little wind turbine and goes through the solar thermal, so there's not much of it, but you know, everything about it is sustainable. And what I'm doing with the 3 acres is turning it into a wildlife haven, a bee sanctuary, an area where I can demonstrate for people what works and what doesn't work. So you know, whether you've just got enough space for a window box or whether you've got enough space for a meadow in your garden, if you come to a course or a workshop at Bumblebee Farm, I will be able to say, look at this window box, it's full of lavender and sage and rosemary, and look at the bees, and look at that one with the petunias and the busy lizzies, you know, death, nothing. All of these bedding plants. So it's to be a working example, but not just about bees. It's about wildlife, biodiversity, all sorts of things. People who have come to help me there already seem to have... It's got a healing energy about it. It's like a little bubble in a village, and the people who have been helping have just not wanted to leave, which is a bit scary as well. But yeah, it's a beautiful place, and I just want you to know about it because I need help. Next year I would need help with the growing and the clearing and people running workshops, you know, whether it's spoon carving workshops or making your own herbal teas or plants dyeing anything. It's not just about bees. And then also, if there are any millionaires here, and I'm just, you know, it's like put it out there to the universe because I'm doing the whole trying to bring abundance in. What I need to get through the winter to make the project happen is money. I've had to go back into the money world. I don't really like it. So if anyone knows anyone who would like to donate to make this happen, or even say, I'd like to donate for a window box, please, as I don't, you know, that would be great. So that's it. That's me. And I'm going to finish by saying, next time you see a bee, please, please remember to thank it. Thank you.
Talk, but in view of all that you've said, what are your views on us eating honey?
Wow, okay, so that's very personal. My views on eating honey are that honey should be treated as a medicine. We should not be taking honey from the hives. We're talking honeybees here. Only honeybees make honey, by the way. I cannot believe that people are still extracting honey from hives and replacing it with sugar syrup over winter when the bees actually have worked so hard to get what little honey they have left. So for that reason, you know, unless you have, if you keep bees yourself, if you know that they have plenty of honey left in May, and then you extract some, then I'm okay with it. But not if you take it away before the winter.
And same with overseas honey.
Oh my goodness, totally with overseas honey. I would say if you can't source your honey, if you don't know where your honey's come from, with everything, if you don't know where it's come from, you know, think twice before you buy it and eat it and use it and wear it. Check the source. And the same with propolis. Don't go near royal jelly. Royal jelly is for queen bees. It is not for human faces. And propolis, when it's extracted in tiny quantities from someone, propolis is just the most wonderful substance, antiseptic. You can put a drop of propolis tincture on a septic wound and it will heal. But don't buy it in bottles from people like Hollands and Barretts. Find a local beekeeper and know that you've just taken a tiny little bit of the propolis. So, yeah, okay. Thank you.
Hi there, Brigit. You were talking about the neonicotinoids. The most currently effective flea treatment is made by Bayer, and it's imidacloprid.
Imidacloprid, fipronil as well.
Fipronil is another one, but that's kind of going out, it doesn't really work on fleas anymore, but the one by Bayer is the most effective. So I don't know how many, if you calculated, how much of that is actually going on to animals and getting washed off into the environment and getting excreted with urine. I don't know how it compares with an agricultural use. But it's probably quite significant.
It's significant. It, compared with agricultural use, it's a drop in the ocean, but it is significant because, especially because it comes out in dogs and cats' urine. It does go, by its nature, it goes straight through and onto the ground and into the groundwater, so it is significant. And if you do have a pet and you're treating it with a flea treatment, have a look, and you're looking for imidacloprid, and that is a neonicotinoid, and really worth looking for alternatives. Far easier for dogs, because you can use an awful lot more natural remedies for dogs than you can on cats. Cats are a challenge. So with cats, it's grooming. But yeah, it's significant.
You got any suggestions for dogs then?
Dogs, I think, gosh, I'm not a herbalist, so I think neem oil, yes. Yeah.
Yeah, neem oil seems to be about the best.
Yeah.
I don't know if I just can contribute something else. It's just in my mind, in terms of leaving perhaps water out for bees, in that I have successfully cleared silverleaf from my orchard in the past with, I got a proper sprayer and mixed up various herbal tinctures and in water. And it's just in my mind, and has been for a while, of even making a herbal tea of nettle.
Yeah,
and maybe a drop of wormwood in it. And
if so, wormwood.
You could leave a herbal tea out for the bees.
Yes, of course.
Because, you know, nettle's one of the most wonderful things for strengthening the immune system. And things like wormwood and green walnut shell. I mean, you can buy these herbs too. You don't have to prepare it all. But I'm just thinking of the idea of leaving a herb tea out for bees.
And there is a lot of information out there on the internet. There's, you know, we're not short of information on the internet for alternatives. Thank you.
I suppose another thing for the bees is to make sure there's a really wide range of things that you want to forage on.
Oh gosh, you know, yes.
If they don't get a wide range of pollen sources,
yes,
their immune system suffers.
Yeah, I should have said that. That's terribly important. Bees need foraging throughout the year, so you need to be planting things. You know, either you and then your next door neighbour can cover April, next door neighbour from there can cover June, July. You need to have lots of foraging and huge variety of shapes and colours and types of flowers, because they, like us, need a variety. And stick an apple tree in your garden, because apple pollen is one of the best things for bees, and it's a really, really good immune booster for bees.
Yeah, just a point about GMO farming. I'm sure you didn't want to apply that it's going to be pesticide-free. I mean,
particularly,
the use of herbicide in GMO farming is horrendous, particularly once you get resistance of herbs to you know, the glyphosate and other sprays that I currently use. So, and then even worse herbicides they use in order to replace those ones.
And we're being told that, in case there was anybody here who thinks that genetically modified food is the way forward, we're being told that it will save us from using pesticides. Of course it doesn't. That is a great big whopper.
Just to you, Brigit, or to anyone else, good sources for wildflower seeds. Because twice I've been given packets and gone to
Be Happy Plants.
And nothing happened.
Be Happy Plants.
And how best to cultivate them as well.
Harvesting your own local, so native wildflower seeds. Get in touch with the Wildlife Trust. I know people in Herefordshire who've got in touch with their Wildlife Trust, and they're called Plant Wild. So anyone in that area, they now harvest and sell. And there's also another guy called Habitat Aid, and he might be able to, if you contact Nick on Habitat Aid, he will point you towards your best local, but try to go with local regional seeds if possible, wildflower seeds. Yeah. Oh, in that case, Tamar Organics. I buy seeds from them. Seriously, Tamar Organics are good. Why not? No, just to reiterate, you know, just remember, no bee ever gave you an invoice. They're precious, incredible beings. And if you, one last thing, you know, get out and sit with them. Fall in love with them. Fall back in love with nature again. And to come full circle, once you fall in love with nature again, you cannot harm it. And that's what it's all about, just getting out there and being with the bees. Oh, yes, don't mow your lawns. Leave your mow. Be a lazy gardener. Let your lawns grow at least long enough for the clovers and the vetches and the self-heals. We do not need hoovered lawns. We just do not. Just a little track through it if you want to get from A to B, but lawns and dandelions. Leave your dandelions. Make friends with your bindweed. You know, chat to your burdock. All of these are like bee magnets and bee heaven. So, thank you. Thank you very much.